translation always comes before the intelligence. So yeah, that's how we call artificial intelligence. So the second problem is that we don't have data annotation in the testing phase, because a single data point may contain a large of variance. And if we have the augmentation on the testing data, we can cancel the variance. So the third one we want to try is that we don't want to tune in the network. That's why we have a special solution. Because we don't tune the network, we don't try different architectures, we don't try different loss functions, we don't tune the parameters of the larger margin softmax functions. So as you notice, the top performance algorithms, they reach a very similar performance. Actually, the difference is only 1% or even less than 1%. But now, we are trying to propose a method that is an offline recognition algorithm. It's not an online algorithm. In the training phase, we have several loss functions. We have cosine phase, fair phase, or arc phase. The purpose are same. We want to enlarge the distance between the categories or between the phase classes and narrow down the distance of the intra-class distance. And how about we apply this concept in the testing phase? Can we narrow down the intra-class distance? Yes, of course. But we have several constraints. The first one is no external data. So we are not allowed to train external model. Like we don't allow to train a graphic convolutional network. We don't allow to train another aggregation network. And the second one is the one feature from one testing sample. And the third one is our target. We want to narrow down the distance between the samples of the same class. So the methodology is here. The data is composed by several classes, and each class, the features forms a Gaussian distribution. And our target is to push every feature to its own corresponding class center. So our basic assumption is every class that allows the Gaussian distribution. And so we want to have an iterative update of the feature. So here is very similar to the gradient descent algorithm. We have the update, we have the formal feature, and we have the next feature. And so actually this one is equivalent to the EMA, so the exponential moving average. So we have the continuous form of our algorithm. Actually, if we assume that the feature continuous distributing in the space, we can integral in the neighbor area. And then we can, after the integration, we can have this kind of formula. Actually, it's equivalent to the previous one. And but in real case, our features are discrete. So that means these features are not continuous. So we need to form a graph to do this computation. So actually in the graph, we have the affinity matrix, which is the key of the graph method. And affinity is very simple. It's only the feature matrix multiplied by the transpose of the feature matrix. And after that, because we don't want to integrate on the whole space, we only want to integrate on the neighboring space. So we have to set a threshold. And we also need to set the KNN. It's another constraint of our neighboring criteria. So this one denotes the Iverson brackets. And if this in the bracket is true, then it's 1. Otherwise, it's 0. So with this kind of affinity matrix, we can do the feature updating method. And it's iterative updating as the previous slide. So here are some experiments. Result. We first do the experiments on the very widely used open source testing data set. It's called the IJPC. So this one, test one, we use is template-based matching. And so you may wonder that we have different threshold, we have different KNNs. So how can we set the parameters? I will tell you that doesn't matter. we have tried different k values, we have tried different thresholds, and they also get a much performance than the baseline. So the next one is that the left is our template-based matching, and the right one is our sample-based matching. So in the sample-based matching, we also get an improvement that shows our efficient effectiveness of our proposed method. So it's the experiment results on this competition. So that's why we are called special methods, because we don't want to tune the networks. So our base performance of our network is very poor. You can see in the light one, we only have 0.82. But after this aggregation, after this clustering, we can reach the 0.93 performance. And in the lightweight of the light IGE dataset, we can improve the performance from 0.57 to 0.72, which is a large improvement. And after this, actually, we have tried in the heavy Xidian dataset. The baseline, I just used the model from the official published model, and it's 0.92. And after our methods becomes 0.97, but actually, if we try to tune the parameters, if the best parameter can reach the performance above 0.99. Mm-hmm. So of course we are doing the clustering method. Using the clustering, we enable the possibility to have the semi-supervised learning. So we also try the semi-supervised learning in this competition. The x-axis is the proportion of the label data. So the other data, we remove the label and make it unlabeled data, and use our clustering to do the pseudo-labeling and do the semi-supervised learning pipeline. So you can see the baseline is the, we only use the label data for training. And the blue line is we use the full data for training. And the green line is our semi-supervised learning approach, which